Thank you for tuning in to Ungentrified with Kent Johnson. Ungentrified takes an unfiltered view on pop culture, music, television and film, politics, current events, and topics central to the worldwide Black community. Ungentrified is a safe audio space for celebrating Black culture in its purest form. What up, good people? It's your boy Kent, and we're back with another very special episode of Ungentrified. Of course, I have B with me.
Hey!
And we are here to discuss episode 5 of season 4 of Insecure, episode 5 titled Low-Key Moving On, aka the Block Party episode. A.K.A. Love and Hip Hop,
Englewood. Oh my God, it was so good. It was real good. I was jamming the whole time.
Yeah, it was a lot going on. But look, this would be the part where if we had like a full-blown production crew, I'd be like, roll that clip from last week when I said it was going to be people popping up that we ain't seen in a long time and that Nathan was going to pop up.
And yep, Nathan was in full force this episode.
Yeah, because I was like, it's that point in the season. They have done this in seasons past where the people we ain't seen in a minute just pop up out of nowhere. And like you said, Nathan popped up in them DMs. Actually, Issa popped in them DMs, if I remember correctly. She sent him a message first.
Yeah, which was weird to me because I was like, don't you have his phone number? Because his name popped up when he called her in the last episode. His name popped up on her phone. So I was like, so you have his number. But whatever. Yeah. That's those young people. They be doing different stuff.
Yeah, she hit him up in the DMs and they got to talking again. And, well, she woke up in the middle of the night, which it was the day before the festival.
Right? Yeah, so she was. Yeah, I think she was having like all those, anxieties about like what will lead to the next day. I think she even said like, "I'm wondering if it's going to be the one time of year that it actually rains in LA."
Right. Yeah, so she's freaking out, having like you say pre-event jitters, but then that gives us a timeline too for things later on in the episode. So the day of or the day before, she gets to talking to Nathan, and they have a cool reintroductory conversation, but it brings us back to the point where the season started, where Issa says that she don't fuck with Molly anymore. So now we've come full circle. We are back at the point where we started. So no more in the past leading up to it. We are at the point where she don't fuck with Molly no more. And I don't know about you, but I never expected for Nathan to be on the receiving end of
that call. That,
yeah. But it makes sense.
But you know what? It actually like hit harder for me this time. Like when I heard it in the first episode, I was like, ooh, like intrigue or like, how did we get there? But when she said it last night, it felt like if it was a different take, like with Venom, like I really don't fuck with Miley no more. Like she was pissed.
And then I think for a lot of us, it was like, oh, well, we know why. We understand.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't mess with her neither.
Right. I fully came into that. Like, yeah, let's roll. Hey, guns blazing. We all don't mess with Molly right now. Mm-hmm. But yeah, so that kind of put us back into the perspective for the episode. And then we cut to Molly, who's with Andrew, and this is the day of the event now. And she's being nasty, acting like she don't even want to go to the event and trying to think of excuses not to go. And of course, Andrew's like, why are you acting this way? He hasn't really come out and said it yet, but he's just like, you know, we're going.
You being childish.
Right. Like, come on, stop playing.
Yeah. You know, that whole scene, I was like, shout out to Andrew, who is really like holding this thing together and really like, you're being ridiculous right now. Like, you know what you're going to wear. You know that we go into this thing. As a matter of fact, he even played her and was like, all right, then let's not go. And she was like, well, you know, I got to go. So right. He like called her bluff and was like, all right, then get ready.
Exactly. Yeah, he's been very level-headed, and I think it's what Molly needs. Of course, she doesn't like it when that level-headedness is used against her, but she could see, in this case, it's for Issa, so she can project and it'd be okay. But if it was coming directly at her, she would have had a problem with it. But yeah, she's also letting us know that she felt a way about Issa not showing up to, I guess, a celebratory dinner she had for winning that big case at work. But Andrew points out now and later on in the episode, like, Issa's been busy. Like, it's a big thing going on. But Molly just kind of cast that to the side and was upset that the seafood platter didn't get equally distributed amongst four people.
But I honestly, this episode, like, I already loved Andrew, but this episode, I was really feeling him because he was seriously like the bigger person, really trying to help her navigate through this relationship, and was like, this is, like you said, he was like, look at all this hard work she put in. Doesn't this look like it would take her a lot of, time? Remember when you was dissing me for work because you had a lot going on? Like, he was really trying to help bridge that relationship. Even, and like, I think that kind of showed like where they are in their relationship, like being a good boyfriend and just kind of like helping her get over the hump to like get over herself, but
Right.
in a kind way, because she knows that she's more likely to take that criticism from him.
So they're going to the event, and of course we cut back to Issa, who's at the site of the event now and going through all of the craziness that comes with putting on an event. I know you know this because of the work that you do. I know it too because of the space that I'm in. It's just a very frazzled time, and you're trying to put out as many fires as you can, and fires keep popping up, and you just in another space. And while she's walking the grounds, checking everything, trying to make sure everybody's good, who do we see but Condola? And you know what? I said, was it last week, that we weren't gonna call her outside her name no more? But I'm condemning her this week. So her name is Condemn because she know she ain't need to pop up at that event. Like, where the hell you been, Condola? Where the hell have you been?
Yeah, I was kind of like, I mean, I think she did need to pop up because that was, those were all her relationships that she was trying to check on. But I it was just like such a weird vibe. Like, even Issa was like, what you doing here? Like, I
Right.
did not expect you to be here. And now that you're here, you didn't even like reach out to me. You didn't speak to me. You didn't let me know you was coming. Like, that whole thing was just so weird.
Yeah.
But I understand why she was there to check up on everything. I just think the way that she did it was awkward and wrong. Like, she was just dead wrong for everything, honestly.
Yeah. Yeah. And then, well, I know now, I'm pretty sure that this is how Condola operates, is that she throws questions out there to see what kind of response she gets. Like, they're very fishy questions. Like, she's always trying to. Yeah.
Calculated.
So she's like, oh, so you don't know? Which,
You didn't talk to Lauren?
right. Because she wants to find out, oh, because I know y'all got back together. Like, that's her mindset and coming into that kind of question. Similar to how she asked that ignorant ass question at Thanksgiving. Doing something like, if y'all, if she hadn't cheated, would y'all still be together? Those kinds of questions are problematic. And of course, he's just like, no, I don't know what you're talking about, because ain't nothing been going on with her and Lawrence outside of, them just being cordial. And
Yeah, so
then.
I'm kind of glad that they didn't have that talk, the last time we saw them together, because it kind of put egg on Condola's face when she was like, I don't know what you're talking about. But outside of that, you're supposed to be a business professional.
Right.
If you didn't ever know, I mean, like, you met them separate. And you volunteered your time separate. So if you didn't know that they had ever dated in the past or whatever, like, you should have just been carrying this on in a business professional type of manner. Like, let me just do the work. We don't need to be having cocktails and having long lunches and stuff like that. I can email you this and structure this, make the phone calls. Like, she totally could have done the right thing. And she just was a big old messy Betty.
Right. And completely let her emotions get the best of her because, like you said earlier, she had constituents there. She had partners there. She had folks that she, leveraged her connections with there. So you would want to make sure that the event went off without a hitch because your name is on the line in some way. And you would want to put your emotions to the side, whatever they may be, just to make sure that your professional life isn't impacted in any way. But she didn't care. She was, gung ho about being all of her feelings and didn't care up until she was like, oh, well, I guess I need to check on the Spotify track and make sure it's good. Like,
Right. But even like she, that's what really bothers me, honestly, is that she could have at any point said, hey, I'm out. Like, something came up. She could have lied and said, like, work came up and she couldn't possibly do both things. She could have said, she could have told Issa what happened. You know what? Me and Lawrence got into it. I just don't feel like working with you anymore. I don't feel comfortable, whatever. But she just ghosted Issa and was, it just left her out to dry. And what if, the rapper wouldn't have been able to come? Like, what if it would have been like a bad rap? I mean, who knows what the aftermath is on this place anyway, but who, what if this whole thing would have went south and she had leveraged all her connections to be there and having them think that things are like going well and everything falls apart? Or what if Issa would have been like, bunk this, we're gonna have to cancel or whatever the last minute because I couldn't get who I or she quit like she normally does. So I mean, like, she could have saved the day, honestly. Issa wouldn't have had to go to anybody else. She could have, maybe backfilled with some other performer or something had she been involved. So honestly, like, Issa really carried herself well and was like, all right, then I'll see you around. And wasn't even trying to, like, she wasn't rude to her, but she was also like, I'm good now. Like, you don't need to be here. I got this now.
Yeah, I think that's been Issa's kind of approach this whole season. Is like once people present her with stuff like that, she's like, okay, like I have gotten to this point, I'm good. Like, I'm not going to invest any more into whatever it is brought us here. So yeah, shout out to Issa for not letting that catch her off guard, especially when, I don't know if you caught this, but I was cracking up when she had the interview with the YouTube girl, and
Yeah,
she spoke
the
about
press.
black, yes, the press, right? The black excellence on display, and it was nothing but white people in the background.
Yeah, I did. Well, because also the assistant later say they think this is a farmer's market. So yes, I peeped all of that.
But then, knowing how black folks operate, they definitely did show up at the time where I would have
At
expected them
the
to. You
end.
don't
Right
show
when
up
everything
right.
was cracking up.
Yeah, when them doors open, you show up right before the artist that you like is about to come on.
Yep, because our Caucasian brethren, they always early.
They
If you say noon, they there at 11:30.
right, helping you set up and put out chairs. Yeah.
Yes, and when I say help you, when you're saying me, it really is me. Like, anytime I throw an event, I'm always getting help. Son of my Lord, always starting about an hour late. So shout out to Issa for being ready on time, even though her guests weren't ready on time.
But like you said, Issa was definitely ready on time. Things were going smoothly through the event. And of course, everybody's there, Molly, Tiffany, and Kelly.
Kelly.
or Kelly,
Kelly.
right?
Yeah.
With that fake English accent for her super LA dumb boyfriend of the week with
Yeah.
his two branches of government.
Oh my goodness, yes. That's why Bank of America, that's why they're everywhere. There's so many of them. Oh my God, I can't.
But Molly, I think, is definitely feeling a little guilty because she's actually seeing that Issa's hard work paid off. Like, there was nothing for her to complain about. And you mentioned it earlier. Andrew even points out like her contradiction about like, see, this is all of the hard work that Issa's been, wrapped up in the last couple of months. Like, hey, remember when you were busy and you ain't had time for me? Like, and I had to deal with it. He really kind of put her on blast about it. Like you said, he really was kind of the normalizing line throughout this entire episode. And Molly went and got some, I don't know, some Well, she had humble pie during Thanksgiving. She had some humble wings,
Yes.
humble hot wings, to offer as a peace offering to Issa. And but I also felt like she was gonna try to forge into the conversation that they've been needing to have. And it was like, this is it ain't the place. It wasn't the
Yeah.
place.
No.
But
You're right. Like it's I think your theme has totally been on point this whole time. Everything is about timing, and this episode is the, picture perfect view of timing where, she was trying to have that conversation with her and that didn't work out, and then obviously, everything that happened afterwards between them was all about timing. So it kind of it sucks that that's been what's been tearing them apart, or like not tearing them apart, but what has been like p a piece of them falling apart. Something so small as timing. Like if you have that communication together, you should be able to overcome something that small. But in this instance, that meant everything. Timing was everything.
So that moment that Molly tried to have didn't happen because of course Issa's busy. She's got to be on all day for this. But another person popped up. Well, we actually get to see Nathan in the flesh, so it wasn't just a phone call. Nathan actually showed up to the event. And also another person we ain't seen in a while, Thug Yoda. The blood from
I know.
the Dunes popped up.
Everything is boo. Everything is boo.
And
He was
at
like,
this
everybody's
point,
name was Barry, Bonnie. Yes, I
at
love
this point,
him.
I actually thought we were going to see Daniel. That wouldn't have been a surprise for me, but we did not.
No, he did cross my mind though.
And another person we didn't see was Lawrence. Where was Lawrence
Lawrence.
at?
I know. I thought about that too.
But I figured, his thought process would be, hey, because he doesn't know what's happening with Condola and Issa, so he's probably like, look, both of them going to be in the spot. It's probably best that I wouldn't be there just to not deal with that. And who knows, he may be dealing with some shit on his own. He may not have a job right now,
He
because
might not. That's
where we left
true. I
him
forgot
in the
about that.
last episode.
But I still think he should have been there. Like I forget who said it, but they were like, we're all here. I think it might have been Molly saying, no, of course we're all here. But he was literally the only one who wasn't there. So I think that was kind of weird that he didn't show up just to show support. Because their relationship has grown and become so amicable, I would have thought that even if it was just like a stop through, he would have been like, I just came to say, great job, congratulations. I can't stay, but I just wanted to check in and let you know that I was supportive or something. A text message, anything. He was like ghost this whole episode.
There was no mention, not even a "you did it" text. Like, yeah,
And
nothing.
no one asked about him either. Like, oh, have you seen Lawrence? Is Lawrence coming? Nobody. He just didn't exist this episode.
And like I said, Derek was there, so he definitely would have had somebody to like chill with at the event. Well, Derek was there temporarily. Let's go ahead and dive into what's clearly happening with Tiffany and Derek and the new baby. So Tiffany was definitely on one with the postpartum depression vibes this episode. Everything from what, "I'm gonna leave my baby in the
As a supermarket,
supermarket."
yes, and everybody did that awkward, like, is she joking? Like, is this real? Did she do it?
And
Yes.
the latching issue that the baby was having. So the baby didn't latch onto her during breastfeeding, and she was kind of like, "Ugh, that's her loss."
She don't get some of this beautiful booby. Yes. I mean, I will say that that is postpartum or not, that is a huge thing, after you just had a baby, is whether or not the baby latched. But from what I've seen over the, couple of episodes that we've had her with the baby, is I don't know that she actually tried to nurse, because she because latching has nothing to do with breast milk, and fed baby is best. I'll just throw that out there so it doesn't sound like I'm, championing for breast milk or anything like that. But I'm just saying, like in the last episode, we saw her pumping so that she could drink, or I think she was drinking and pumping, I'm
Yeah,
not
she was.
sure. So I don't think that you could still pump, and even if the baby's not allowed to, is my point. And I just think that, A, some parents just don't really care about doing breast milk. They're, as long as baby eats, they'll do the formula, that's fine. But I think the other side of that is she's been drinking a lot, which, wait, that's me too. She's been I'm in quarantine though. But she's been drinking a lot, and she's just, I don't have time for this baby. Like, mama gotta have a life. Derek, you go handle the baby because I'm out already. I finally get some breathing, some time away from the baby. That baby's always crying, always screaming. Like, she's don't want anything to do with that baby right now, breastfeeding or not. And so I think that, that those were all clear signs that she's going through something right now.
Yeah. And Derek's having a very different response to parenthood. Like, he seems to be kind of on it, like documenting what the stool looks like every time she goes to the bathroom, to
You
being,
do do that, yes.
the parent who's on the phone with the sitter trying to navigate through it, and being the parent that's like, no, you can stay, I'll go pick her up, and just very
Which I think
different
is also
responses.
like, yeah, I think that's also like a super, like a natural thing. Like, when one isn't, like available, the other one is, usually steps up to pick up the slack. That's usually the mom. I'm not gonna say that guys don't do it. I'm just saying it's typically or most generally thought to be the mom is picking up all the slack of, handling those baby things. So commend, I commend him for stepping in and, taking up that role. But what I want to see him do is acknowledge that something ain't right,
Right. And for
and they need to talk
everybody to
about
kind of
it.
speak up on it.
Have an intervention,
Right.
maybe.
And I could see it being a thing of Tiffany having this idea of what a perfect mom would be and her perfect family would be. And when the baby came and was an actual human and had emotions and things that she couldn't necessarily control easily, she kind of you just like toss it to the side. I know folks are still pushing that theory that that baby ain't Derek's, and there's a whole another thing
Oh,
going
dang.
on with it. I hope that that is
Oh, that
not the
would be
case.
devastating
Yeah, right.
since he's the one picking up the slack. That would be devastating for him
Right.
if that was his baby. But I don't think that's, I
Yeah.
don't know. I just didn't even think about that. And honestly, like, postpartum is like a chemical thing. But she dropped I think she's definitely pushing everything that's mom away, right? Like, she dropped those mommy friends. She's not nursing or breastfeeding or anything. She's not responding to the nannies and all that. So anything to do with being a mom right now is, I can't be bothered. So and I like to think back to like when I had my first kid, and it was super challenging. And even though I wasn't like that per se, I feel like now looking back, I maybe had like a very mild case of it. Not like where I wanted to like hurt my baby or anything like that, but like you're just kind of like disassociated a little bit because it's something chemically is just not connecting. Whereas like this time it's totally different and it's just a more enjoyable experience, I guess. I don't know, but I just think that people outside, like outside of you, notice these things and typically say something to you. And I'm hoping that her friends, like, now that this is winding down and Molly's case is winding, that's done. Now they can kind of like focus in, or even maybe just have like, let Kelly do it because, that's the ride or die.
Right.
Because she was giving her crazy looks, and Kelly don't care about nobody but herself. And she was like,
Right. Yeah, something ain't right. And we
Yeah.
definitely need to address it. But the thing that heals all black souls is a community, yes, a community
The
dance to the wobble. And it seems
Yeah.
like everything is right in the world. Like Molly and Issa have a moment, during the wobble. It just everyone's in a good space. It's the diaspora is good right now.
And can I just also say that this was literally like the most Cali entertainment I've ever heard. Like, all of that music was totally like LA, totally Cali. And I personally don't listen to the radio, so I don't know if these are any real artists or not. But I was jamming to them just the same. in my Cali dance moves. Like I was getting a little bit hypey. Like I was like really like dancing to everything, and I had my baby dancing. It was good times. And then when the wobble came on, oh, that just shut it all down. I was excited.
And
I was at the event.
I don't know what it is about black women and the wobble, but at any event that I've been to, black women could be totally immersed in something else and they hear that, oh, and go directly to the floor. And look, it's like they're contractually obligated to do the wobble anytime that they hear it. And when
It's
it's
our
done, they go
grown
back.
woman back that ass up. Like, it's Cash Money taking over for the 99, but like in 2020.
It never fails. And look, fun fact, I used to work with the mother of the guy who wrote that song. So I know I
Nice.
have a close connection to black royalty, okay? So
Oh, nice.
but yeah, like I
Oh my
said,
goodness.
everything
It's our
feels
young Frankie Beverly. How's
yes.
that?
Everything feels good. Molly did actually tell Issa that, things, hey, this really looks good when she tried to give over the humble hot wing. So, things, we feel like things are in a good space. But this was just a false sense of security for the last like 7 minutes of the episode where, as Molly and Andrew are about to leave, Vince Staples, who was the headliner for the show, his manager comes up to Andrew and is like, "Hey, when you got a moment, Vince wants to say what's up before you head out." And he thanks Andrew for the hookup, right? So
For putting them
Molly's
on,
like,
yeah.
"Yeah, like, what's the hookup? What's going on? Hey, what's happening?"
Like she didn't put two and two together already.
Right. And Andrew lets her know. He was like, "Oh yeah, Issa needed help, and I put them two together. I connected them." And
Seems
Molly's
like it
like,
was just a simple email.
"Right?" And Molly's like, "What? What? Huh?" And he's like, "Yeah, I didn't think you'd have a problem with me helping out your best friend." Boop.
Wrong.
So, right, because clearly she had all of the problems, and really launched into this whole tirade. Now, mind you, the event is still going on. So she approaches Issa and is already in an accusatory, like, "You went behind my back," and asked, she didn't even hit her with Andrew, "My man." You asked my, whenever women do the "my man,"
It's serious.
That's not coming up in a regular conversation. That's not coming up in a happy moment. My man. So,
Like you called my man
right.
behind my back. Whoa, okay.
Yeah. After I specifically told you,
Not like a mama.
right, that wasn't gonna happen. And Issa had to hit her with, "No, you told me not to ask you. You wasn't gonna do it." So I did it. And we find out that when Issa and Nathan started talking again, she was telling him about all the stress of the event and how she lost her headliner. And Nathan asked Andrew about it, and they connected and made it happen. And that must have happened really quickly because
Yeah, because it was the day before.
it was the day
It was at
before.
2 a.m.
Right. So it was really like punching the clock towards the timeline kind of situation. It was 11th hour saving moment. And Molly is pissed. Like, pissed. She's throwing around, "You stabbed me in the back." She called her a shady bitch. Like, how you gonna do the wobble with me? The wobble is sacred.
And
And
Issa's like, whoa, like it was just a little like a little ass favor. She was like, you stay needing little ass favors. And I was
right.
like, whoa.
Yeah. It really became a full-blown like battle between these two. We've seen them little nitpicks throughout the season, but Molly, and see, okay, this is what I've learned about Molly. Molly needs a grace period. She reacts to everything like very gutturally in the immediate. and it's usually wrong. Her immediate reaction is usually wrong. And then she has like that little grace period where somebody knocks some sense into her, or she hears something that rings a bell and was like, oh, you know what? And then she comes back and says the right thing. But usually the first thing in her mouth ain't the right thing. And this is, we getting a whole
That,
bunch of that moment
like, if
right
Issa
now.
wasn't standing right there and she had to like look for her after the event or something, it might have gone
Right.
different. But the fact that she heard the news and saw her and just made a beeline, then yes, she went with her first gut.
Right. Yeah. And then it's just like, why would you do it here? But Molly doesn't think about that. Molly doesn't care about the environment because she's done it before. I had to do an accounting of like what we know about them from season one to now, and this is Molly's, modus, her MO, just how she handles things. She does things at the most inopportune time. She tried to call Issa out at the fundraiser that she had for We Got Y'all, way back in the first season. So, but it was just like, why are we doing this right now? Even Andrew was like, look, we don't have to do this here. Tiffany, drunk Tiffany, was like,
Hey
hey.
guys.
Right, but at that point, it had to be about Molly. Molly needed to feel like, she was getting the upper hand on something.
And I need to reprimand her for doing what I asked her not to do. Don't involve me, or like stand on your own 2 feet. And I think that's something else too that goes through her mind, is that she's so successful and she did it on her own. You know, like she really didn't have the help or handouts or friends to back her up the way, you know, Issa's needed her friends, or like utilizes her, you know, connections, her network. So I think that's her other thing, is like when this didn't go the way I knew you was gonna fail anyway. You were about to fail, and then you used, you know, my connections to make your shit work. Even though to me, she had every right to tell Nathan, and Nathan go and ask. Like, I don't think she did anything wrong in that way. I agreed with Molly when she said you stayed needing little, you know, little ass favors. That is true. But I don't think that what Issa did was wrong. She didn't, like, if she would have directly contacted Andrew, that would have been something different. But
Right.
the fact that she was just having that conversation with Nathan, and Nathan did it, that to me was like, that was the right thing to do. And why would you want your friend to fail? Even if y'all are not on the best of, you know, like playing grounds right now, like if you're not going through the best of your relationship right now, why? That's a huge fail. That's not like a I sent the wrong email kind of fail.
Right.
That is like you would have been letting down all those vendors that came, all the community, all the goodwill that you put into that community that you could make this happen, like from one little thing. Like, why would you deny her that when, you know, it's something so, like he said, it was something so simple. Now, if he had to set up meetings and negotiate and do pricing structure, like if he had to do all of that, I can understand why she wouldn't want him involved. But he said it was literally an email to my friend.
Right. And we know that if Molly had asked, he would have done it. So that would have saved Issa all this kinds of stress and being freaked out about it. And having to contact Nathan, even though it doesn't seem like they're in a bad space right now. But that would have had things going a completely different direction had Molly been open to doing that. But we know now that Molly and Issa's relationship, at least to Molly, is centered around Molly being on top. It doesn't function for Molly if Issa gets anywhere close to being successful or having things in order. Molly needs something to berate Issa about, needs something to look down on Issa about. And
I agree.
she finally got that moment of, like you said, like I knew you couldn't do it on your own, or I knew it was some shit was gonna go down at this event. Meanwhile, you the shit that went down at the event. Like,
Yeah,
you're the
because
reason
even if
why
she
things
didn't
went
feel
crazy.
comfortable, yeah, even if she didn't feel comfortable asking Andrew, she could have just voiced it, right? She could have just been like, oh man, Issa's headliner went out on her, and I think she's trying to figure out what she could do it. You know, like she could have just said it like abstractly just to see if he volunteered or if he was like, oh, that sucks. Like, you know, like she could have done that. But if she went in saying, nah, I'm not even going, like you on your own, figure this shit out on your own. If you fail, you fail. If you, but she, the whole time, like you, like we've been saying this whole time, like from when she had the meet and greet in her courtyard, like Molly did, was like, this is a tiny little function. This don't mean nothing. And, you know, we just going to stop by to all the way to now where she was like, I don't even feel like getting dressed to go to this thing. Like she has not wanted this to be successful and she has not given any positive light to it, even though everybody else is all excited. You got Kelly at the step and repeat. You got you know, you got even Derek there, like trying to like get his woman, like you know, Tiffany, just kind of like in a good vibe. Like, do you need a cocktail? Like, let's just kind of keep it going until he has to bail. Like everybody's like super there, supportive, excited. Even Condola made a made her way there, not necessarily to be supportive, but I don't know, just to show her face. You're the only one there that's there negatively. You even got old boy the blood there talking about like how he know everybody, everything's great, he's having a good time. Like everybody's having a good time, but nasty Molly. So
And
I'm mad at that.
yeah, I also picked up on something. It was, or at least I took it as Molly's been keeping stuff from Andrew. If that's her man, and they at that part of their relationship, why wouldn't you tell your dude that you are going through it with your best friend? Like, that would be something that you would have a conversation about, at least even if it was casual, like, oh, you know, Issa get on my nerves right now, or da 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 da. Like, you would have had that conversation. But
But I feel like she kind of was telling him. But what I took from that conversation is that she wasn't as through as Issa was. Because when Issa, the night before, Issa was like, I don't really fuck with Molly like that no more. But the next day when Molly was getting dressed, she was complaining, but she was still like on board. Like, let me see what the next issue is gonna be. You know, she was still like figuring it out, but she wasn't done until that moment.
It's like you said, she was very much like Big Mama. Like, look, I gotta give you a lesson, but I'm gonna still be there
I'm gonna
to
watch
see
you
you through.
fall. Yeah, so I could say, told you so.
And it was, I don't think it was the level of conversation that she has been, or she picked at Andrew for not having with her and not opening up. Like, how could you get mad at him for not saying, you know, whatever's going on with his family and his sister, and then you keep something like that away from him? That's not even up to me on the scheme of things. Whatever's going on with his sister is far larger than what might be temporarily going on with you and Issa. Then, on top of that, it didn't seem like it was a big deal until she found out that he helped. It was, she was cool until she, but wait, no, you did what? And then it became an issue. But yeah, it's something that Issa pointed out when they were going back and forth with each other. Like, if you and Andrew break up, it ain't gonna be Andrew's fault, it's gonna be your
See,
fault.
well, that's obvious because they've almost broken up 39 times, and it's all been because of something that she's done or said, except for that time with the sister. Like that was really him being kind of weird. But other than that, every other time it's been him, her playing games with him, not calling him, you know, treating him bad, like putting him off. Like every other thing has been something that she did to him. She course corrected, of course, but I mean, how many times have they almost been done before today?
And if we want to, you know, place a hierarchy in place, before he was your man, Issa introduced you to him. So Issa knew Andrew before you knew Andrew, because she knew Nathan. She met them at the same time. So you can't even pull that card, because Issa does have a valid connection to Andrew, to where you aren't the only way to get to him. But of course, that's nothing to Molly. She's, like I said, on a She got blinders on and she got her reason for whatever she's thinking, and that's it. She ain't got no time for reason or a solution. She just want to get whatever she want to get out of her. And then she put that finger up, and you know, finger in the face is Black Girl Violation 202.3 in the code. Yeah,
Get that
and
figure out my face.
right. Yeah, because it's twofold. Like, A, if you bold enough to put your finger in my face, then I'm gonna match that with the get your finger on my face. Like, it's not you gotta meet that finger where it needs to be met at. But of course, black people being scary at large events took that
Oh my
finger.
goodness. Yep, and put a gun on
Right, boom.
it.
Went from an acrylic to a 9 millimeter, just like that.
But can I
And
just say, like, not to be negative about my people, I was pleasantly surprised. Like, right before this whole scene happened, I was in my mind, I was thinking, you know what? I mean, I know this is a TV show, but I'm really glad that this popped off without incident. Like, because, and I, that's the, that's, you know, that might be the negative in me, you know, but the unconscious bias in me. But I was just thinking, like, I'm so glad there was no fights, nobody shot up the place. Like, I was literally thinking that before that scene.
yeah, and so, you know, I when we could go outside, the last big event I went to was in Ghana. It was a Afrochella. It was a big music festival in Ghana, and everybody who went from the U.S. just remarked about how different security was for that event, which was an all-black event. I mean, it's in one of the blackest countries in the world. Ghana's 99% black. And then it's a black music festival. And the security was there to make sure that you didn't bring in a water bottle. Like, they didn't frisk us or nothing. It was the most lax music festival experience I've ever had. Not just as a music festival one, and then as a black music festival or black event in large scale. And we were just like, how is what, huh? What? No. And then, of course, nothing went on at the event. The event went off without a hitch. Ain't no fighting, ain't no fussing. You know, I mean, liquor's flowing, people having a good time, music's playing. None of the worries that we would have if we were going to, like, you know, a Crenshaw festival or Freaknik or something like that. Like, nothing, none of those worries were present for that. So I have that is the last understanding of a large event that I've had. So I've been riding on that, you know, because of course everything is nostalgia now since I can't go outside no more. And but it's
Remember
just
back in January? Oh,
right.
the
But yeah, that's what I was like, you know, things are going off without a hitch. I'm not even thinking about stuff popping off, but like you said, it's, you had that linger in the back of your head, like, whew.
day. I'm
Ain't
so
nothing happened
glad.
yet, but it might. But it might though.
Yeah.
Did you pull into the parking spot, or did you back in?
But you know, that's also probably us too, because I don't know how many of our college parties got broken up with gunfire.
Right.
Like, somebody got stabbed, or it was, and you know, that's not to say anything about Baltimore or HBCU. It's nothing to say about that, but I'm just thinking back to like how many fun events get broken up that way. It's
Right, 'cause
just
somebody don't
because,
know how to act.
yeah, this is usually one knucklehead, or you know, people, you stepped on my shoes, or you know, something stupid that really like just messes the whole thing up for everybody.
Right.
So,
Well, in this case, it was Molly saying, you stepped on my stupid ass rule about not contacting my boyfriend, my man. So I think another thing that happened too during that fight was that as people started to try to pull Molly back, she realized that she ain't have nobody backing her up on this. It just ratcheted up the anger even more because even though Issa was kind of digging back, it was nowhere near what Molly had came to her with. Like, that energy wasn't the same until a certain point in. Because at first, Issa was like, hey, we can talk about this, just not now. Like, I'm at work. I wouldn't roll up to your job with something at work. But
And she was also just trying to explain it. Like, you told me not to ask. you. So I didn't. I told Nathan and he did. You know, you've been coming at me foul from jump. Like she was just kind of like giving her like a rebuttal. It wasn't necessarily anything like accusatory. It was just kind of like, well, this is why we're here because you did this, you did this. It was just kind of like, I'm just responding to your, you know, being a jerk.
Right, right.
And even right before then, like I think something that kind of like showed how even Andrew was feeling was like, oh, well, you should have just told me you didn't want me to help your friend. Like that wasn't even like a, oh, it was he didn't even go there with like it wasn't that big of a deal. He was just like, oh, you should have just told me that you weren't trying to be helpful to your best friend.
Right.
So that showed exactly where his mind was like you wanted her to fail. Like everybody sees that you wanted her to fail, but you. And now this is where we are, and I feel bad about it. It's like that was like the fight of all fights.
Yeah. And since we knew it was coming, it really, I think, just lingered on everybody for a while, because it's just like, oh, okay, we know it's about to pop off. We know it's about to pop off, but I don't think we expected it to pop off at the event. Like, come on now. Like I said, the spite and the pettiness in a move like that is not to be overlooked. And I think it was very important that we ended that. I mean, we ended that same episode the way the first episode ended, where they focused in on that good vibes only sign. So it puts us in a place of like what's going to be coming for the second half of the season, because we're only halfway through. Like,
I know. I this felt like a season finale, so I'm super amped that it's not.
yeah, we definitely have a long, long way to go before the end of the season. And it goes back to what I mentioned earlier about the trailer, where we see them two meet up in a restaurant and it looks like they haven't seen each other for quite some time. So I see that episode, I see that being like a episode 7, episode 8 kind of situation. Who knows? I know one thing. Did you see the previews for next week?
I did, yeah.
Yeah, so next week's episode is Low Key Done, is the title of it. And we see Issa living her best life on her own. So she went to a sip and paint party. And why does she always have that big bottle of Pinot Grigio?
Can I just say, wait, but can I just say, because I forget the name of that big jug, but when I first started dating Tyrese, he brought that everywhere. So, and I was like, oh, is this what we drink it? I forget what it's called. Like it's a specific brand. And he was like, oh, I got that. I feel like it's like Santa Maria or something. He was like, I got that Santa Maria, guys. Like the party's about to start. It's like a
That's
kegger.
y'all. That's a damn Costco, California. That is very regional. I ain't never
That's
seen
not
that
even
over
a cat. No,
here.
that's not even Costco. That is at the grocery store and it's like $5. It's like so I've not ever seen it. I've never paid attention to it. I'm sure it's always been there, but it's on that load. It's like underneath the bottom shelf.
You got to pull open, you got to drag open the shelf underneath and pull it out.
Yes, you gotta pull open the secret compartment of uber cheap drinks.
The 99-cent store wine, y'all cracking me up.
But you know what? Everybody was like, yeah, I got a cup. I'm ready. So they knew that that was the
Right. But yeah, so clearly they haven't been talking for a while. And then when you finish with an event and you ain't got nothing to worry about for a while, you
Oh
do
my
get
God.
back in the streets.
Exhale.
Right. Yeah, like you
He's
said,
like, stress
exhale.
is done. But you know what else I noticed from that particular scene is that it's a group of four. So like right now they're a group of four that's kind of disjointed. And so she's like, let me find my new party people, my new friends. So
Right.
I was like, oh, okay, so maybe she's reconnect or she's connecting with new folks to because you know, now we got Tiffany with the baby, Kelly being well, she dropped that English accent when it was time to get going. She
Right.
was like, nigga, I'm from Philly. But everybody's kind of doing their own thing. I think the symbolism is when they ran from them gunshots, they all spread out.
Right.
So I think like that's them kind of like spreading out a little bit and just kind of They hopefully they'll come back to each other, but right now it's kind of like, let me go do my thing that I already got going on the side, and we'll come back together later.
Right. And I also thought that it was particularly important to note that who went after each girl when the fight happened. So if you notice, Kelly went after Issa and Tiffany went after Molly. And I felt like, and we talked about this earlier in a previous episode, that because they went through something similar to this, you know, a few months ago before the baby got there, they are picking up on the signs too. And they went to the person who's kind of dealing with it the same way they dealt with it months prior. So whereas Kelly is deemed as the one who might be the goof or the fuck up, and Tiffany's deemed as the one who would have had it all together, and those were the sides that they went to console each other. And then when we
Good
see
point.
previews from the next episode, it's Kelly who's on the phone with Issa, who's also taking care of the baby. But she's having that conversation with Issa to try to figure out, like, have they reconciled yet? So I think we're gonna see, I guess you can call it like a sister girl moment, like where everybody comes back together later on. Like you mentioned, like everybody's kind of scattered right now, but Kelly and Tiffany are gonna be key parts into bringing them back together.
Well, that's good. I mean, they made it through, so, and they've all been friends for so long. I mean, I'm confident that it'll work itself out, but sometimes you like, so you know that saying, you got friends for season reasons or forever, and sometimes you, even though they're a forever friend, you go through a season that is trying to just, I guess, like test that friendship and just to help you grow, because you want to grow like a relationship, like a partner relationship. You want to grow together. So they've, like I said, they've known each other forever. And now, in order to grow together, you might have to go through some trials and tribulations that could either tear you apart and y'all are really done and not friends no more. Or it'll, make you guys stronger, and they're already like sisters, so I don't see them really, go, breaking it off. But and definitely, who is Molly really gonna go to? Andrew? Like Andrew, although he's some good D, and they grow in together a little bit, at the end of the day, like that's all she would have, and that's not enough for Molly. She needs more people in her life, so
Right.
she's definitely gonna come back to Issa.
And I think it comes to a point where they both have to acknowledge the new version of themselves. Because that's a part of this rift too, is that they are refusing to acknowledge that the person that they knew before is not the person that they're talking to right now. So, and they haven't even given each other the chance to learn the new person. They are stuck, because they've known each other for so long, they're stuck into these ideas of who the other person is. So they have
I agree.
to, yeah, really sit and be like, okay, no, look, I'm successful now. I'm an event planner now.
I threw a whole block party. I mean, honestly, that's a huge thing. Like, I would never, as my first event, I would never make that my undertaking. I would quit. But so I'm like super proud of her. And then also, like you're saying, like Molly is a relationship person now. So she's working on herself. So she's also, I mean, she has more growing to do, but but so does Issa, right? Like the block party's over. Now what? What are you gonna do now? So hopefully we get some of those answers going, like on the next episode or two.
Yeah, because usually with events like that, you ain't making money, at least not the first time you do
Oh
it.
no.
So,
Those was all favors.
yeah, figuring out what happened next. And then, okay, so predictions for the second half of the season. Do you think that this is the last time we'll see Nathan?
Ooh, that's a good question. I mean, I feel like they wouldn't have brought him back if he didn't have like even just like a little bit more in him, especially because this whole thing exploded based on him. So and his like in like insertion into the situation. So I think we have a little bit more in him. I don't think he's like a long-term character by any means. Like I don't think they're going to get back together, but I do think we'll see him again.
Yeah, no, honestly, I think, and I've said this before in last season when we talked about it, and I think I brought it up in the episodes we've been doing this season, but For me, there's one more fight to be had between Issa and Molly, because I really feel that Molly told Lawrence to leave Issa alone when they ran into each other in the park that one day. Remember this when he first
Oh,
started working
yeah.
back in? I feel like
He did.
this.
I thought we didn't we figure that out? I thought we did.
Yeah, she said like, well, she went there and was like, Issa cheated, but not she's not a cheater, yada yada yada. But there was a open-endedness to that scene that didn't that left, at least to me. I don't know, I could be going somewhere it don't need to take be taken, but I felt like there was something else there. And then we learned that that's just how Molly moves. She does that, mother figure stuff where, no, you're not going to see my baby, you're not gonna mess up her good feelings. She did it to Nathan. So
Nathan,
I mean, Issa already knows about her blocking Nathan, but who knows what happens from that. And then if he does come back into play, how does that play out with Nathan, Andrew, Molly, Issa, what have you? And then what happens with Lawrence for the remainder of the season?
I hope he didn't lose his job because that would suck,
Yeah, it really
especially
would.
in this climate. I hope he did not lose his job. But I mean, even if he did, well, okay. So he, if he did, remember he also met a connect at Condola's Thanksgiving thing. So if he did lose his job, would he be trying to get in with that connect?
Right. Yeah. And then, so have we seen the last of Condola?
Ooh, I don't know. I don't know. That was I feel like it felt final. Like that goodbye felt final, but I don't know because we might need her for something later.
Right. Yeah, I feel like we see, especially as we start to make our way towards the end of the season, I feel like we see a lot of the smaller characters kind of fall to the wayside, and it comes back to the core group, which would be Issa, Molly, Kelly, Tiffany, Lawrence,
And
and
Derek.
yeah, and Derek, and that'd
But
be about it.
actually, even the brother, like he was on this episode, funny as hell, again. Him and Kelly going at it was pure comedy. So and even him kind of taking jabs at Issa's event, like I think it might rain. So I feel like he's becoming more of a central character, at least for this season, because that's been almost like her confidant. One of her main confidants, at least in that Thanksgiving moment. And I feel like maybe there, because he was at the courtyard meet and greet, he was there at Thanksgiving. He was at this event, even if it wasn't like a huge piece. So I think they're kind of like integrating him a lot more. And I definitely want to see him more. So I'm happy
Yeah.
about that.
And he's definitely in the next episode too. I think I remember seeing him in the previews for next week. Because everybody's asking about the fallout and if they've fallen back in with friendship. So yeah, I know at this point I'm really at a loss as to what I would predict for the remainder of the season. I think they're definitely gonna address the postpartum part a little bit more, and then of course the relationship between Molly and Issa, but like I don't have any cards to play for predictions for Andrew and Molly. I don't have any idea of what's going to happen with Issa romantically. With Lawrence not being present in this episode, it leaves a lot to the idea of what his role is going to be in the last couple episodes. I don't know. Because we've been working towards this moment of the, well, why she don't fuck with Molly no more, and now we here. So it's like that was satisfying. It's like, well, hell, I don't know what happens after this.
Yeah, now what? Now it's all a surprise.
So, and we still got 5 episodes left to play with. So there's a lot of ground that could be covered in there. But yeah, no, I think this was a great episode. And it definitely gave us the fight that we deserved after being told that she don't fuck with Molly in episode 1.
Yeah. Well, it be like that sometimes. Sometimes you gotta let them go for a little while.
And I think it hits home because we've all been at this point with a friendship, where you gotta figure out if it's gonna move on. Like you said, reason or season, to figure out where you guys stand. But yeah, Definitely a good episode. Like I said, I think it's a good feeling to not know where things are going to go next, because that gives a whole opportunity for where they could go. So
Yeah.
cool. Hey, if this is what you guys can do and you have 10 episodes, then I'm down for it. I will pay the extra month. HBO Go, which
And wait
reminded
the
me.
extra time, because we did wait a long time for some of
Yeah.
these dang episodes.
Yeah, because y'all just charged me for the second month. I just got that charge. Yeah, so I will
Oh,
pay for one more month after this. I won't ask nobody if I can jump on this for 2 weeks.
stupid.
Yes, that's it for this week. Of course, tune in next week when we take on episode 6, which is Low Key Done. And I guess if you like what we discussed today and think that listening to us talk about this show is a good thing, you can go back and listen to past episodes. They can be found on the website, ungentrifiedpodcast.com. You can also find them wherever you listen to podcasts. If you want to leave us a comment about today's episode or any other episode or any theories that you may have, you can reach out to the show on Instagram and Twitter at ungentrifiedpod. Of course, B, it's always fun to chop it up with you. This is our weekly chat,
Yes.
and I mean, we're always talking throughout the week, but this is our like focused
This is where we actually,
chat,
yeah, where we actually have something important to talk
right?
about. Not just recipes.
Right, not just air fryer recipes, right. But until next week, peace out, everybody.
Bye.